Public Affairs Broadcasting.
Special programming from Rockingham County Radio, rcrlive.com.
All right, good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Community Accents. Today is Friday, April 17th, right here on WLOE WMYN. I'm Kevin Suthard, your public information officer for the Sheriff's Office. Sheriff Page is running just a few minutes late this morning. He'll be here at any minute. That's live broadcast for you. But we'll start off today with something that I think is concerning a lot of Rockingham County residents here these days, and that is the IRS telephone scams that are still going on. Of course, as everyone knows, it's tax season, which it's really ramped up since the beginning of April. We're getting a lot of calls from residents concerned because somebody's calling and saying that they're with the IRS and that they're behind on their taxes and they're fixing to be arrested. Had all kind of variations of this recently start coming in as well. Getting reports now that some people are getting calls, not locally, but around the Triad area, of people claiming to be with various police departments and sheriff's offices, claiming that they're going to come and arrest the individual if they don't pay their taxes. All of this is a scam. It is not something that the IRS condones, nor do the IRS won't call you at all. You'll never get a call, phone call from the IRS. These calls are coming from overseas, and so if you get one, please disregard it. Do not call the number back. It is a fake phone number that they're using to put on the caller ID. Oh, look who just joined us here. Hey. Sheriff Sam Page. I was just explaining the wonders of live radio here. That you got hung up just a little bit, and you were running a few minutes behind.
I've just got in from Washington.
Just got in from Washington. We were just talking about some of the scams that were going around, but we'll come back to that in just a minute.
Well, you're talking about the IRS scam.
The IRS scam. Yeah. We were getting a lot of that.
You're hearing also about that. Didn't they get some calls and complaints on it in Danville area also?
Yeah, they did, and also. A newer scam, this is for our business owners here in Rockingham County. We've got someone calling claiming to be with Duke Power, Duke Energy, now, saying that they are behind on their bill in excess of $1,000. All of them have been to various business owners. And to go and get a prepaid debit card to pay that, or it'll be shut off. The power will be shut off in 20 minutes.
You've talked with Duke Energy, and Duke Energy has told you that when they make inquiries, how do they communicate?
Usually by mail or in person, or I mean, you know, they may send a representative out or something like that.
Telephone.
But they're not going to call you and say you're behind and I'm going to turn off your power. That's not the way that they work. Mm-hmm. I tell anybody anytime that anybody does anything like that, if you've got any question, go ahead and just hang up with them and tell them you're going to check with your local agency. That'll probably be a good enough indicator right there as to whether or not it's a scam, because they may get nasty with you or whatever else over the telephone. And of course, Duke Energy won't do that either, or any other legitimate business. But, and then just call the number that you know is a legitimate number for that business, whether you look it up in your phone book or on, the internet or whatever. And, you can ask then if you have any concern about it, but usually
also,
you're going to know.
If anybody's calls you over the phone and asks for personal information, as we say, do not give it out, please.
You know, these days I just recommend everybody not to even do any business over the phone.
I've actually had people call me and want personal information. And I just tell them, I said, you've got my address, send me the information, and I said, I'll look at it, and then we'll get back with you.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't even like to give out, you know, personal information. Well, I told you, just got back from Washington.
Right. Well, tell us about you now. In true Sheriff Page fashion, you have taken a few days off. You took some vacation time, and instead of going to the beach or Disney World or whatever,
I went to the nation's capital.
Washington, D.C.
And, you know, every time I go to Washington, something happens. Now, I'm sure.
Now this is true.
I'm sure our listeners and our viewers, if you saw on TV, there was a thing called a gyrocopter. It's like kind of like a helicopter. It's a light aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I went to attend the Hold the Feet to the Fire, Hold Their Feet to the Fire program, where myself, some congressmen, some community leaders were able to go and basically communicate on talk radio across the nation for 2 days. Mm-hmm. And we talk about the issues, because, you know, one of the biggest issues is the border issues, the transnational drug trafficking, human trafficking situations that are going on, you know, at our borders, mm-hmm. and how that impacts us across the United States. Well, while I was there, we heard the siren go off the other day about 2 o'clock. And what I've learned, when a siren goes off in D.C., don't go outside, just stay inside the building. And what happened was this guy who was a postal worker apparently had been communicating with the Secret Service for about a year out of Florida. He trucks his gyrocopter, which is kind of like a helicopter, trucks it up to Pennsylvania, about 80 miles away. I was looking at the fuel tank on it, because I was wondering how much, you know, how far he could fly and how much fuel he would carry. Mm-hmm. But he was carrying 535 parcels of mail that I understand that were talking about campaign finance reform. And he was going to deliver those to all, you know, being a postal worker, he's going to make sure those got delivered.
Was wearing his postal uniform.
He was. And on the aircraft, on the tail of the aircraft, it had a postal symbol of the U.S. Postal Service. But anyway, he indicated that he was going to deliver that mail to the congressman. And, of course, when he landed, you know, he communicated before he came in that he was coming in. And then when he came in, of course, you know, he was taken into custody.
Right.
But he had a good landing, and it's something you don't see every day. And had we been outside instead of doing business inside, we probably would have seen that gyrocopter landing out there about a block away from us.
Well, yeah, it's always interesting when you go to Washington. It's always something. I mean, the last time you went, they had that chase up there where they were, the car had rammed into.
This is where I believe it was a lady with a child.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And of course, the officers fired on that car and stuff.
Right.
So you know. Time before I was up there, a suspicious package near where we were doing the radio communications, and they shut down the whole area. Roy, you should have seen this. I mean, they brought in the bomb squad. They brought everything. But it was a suspicious knapsack that was left near the hotel where we were doing the radio row, and basically they shut down about 4 blocks out, and it was kind of hard to do the show that morning. But and they've got a lot of law enforcement up there. But you hear, you know, one thing about Washington. Monday through Friday, 24 hours a day, you hear sirens all the time. But I saw something from a crime prevention standpoint, and I was making some inquiry on this. But if you're in Washington and you see a police officer go by on the lights on top of the car, they're always on blue. They're always just their own.
Mm-hmm.
And my understanding is they learned that from Israel, that it basically it presents a visible presence. So when you see an officer or you see that blue light, you know there's an officer in the area. And it has a psychological deterrent, I understand.
No. Well.
So that's why they do that. But I always wondered why they left the lights on, and that's what I heard while I was up there this time. I met Virginia Johnson, mm-hmm. who is from Reeseville area, mm-hmm. and I was coming back from dinner, and I bumped into her, and she actually works for Governor McCrory. She's his coordinator. Up in D.C. The governor was up in D.C.
Mm-hmm.
I understand the president was in Charlotte this week while I was up in D.C., but the governor of North Carolina was up conducting business in D.C. also. Uh-huh. But I ran into one of my classmates from Reeseville. So that was pretty neat.
It's a small world.
It was a small world.
Yeah.
We got to speak to about, I don't know how many people we got to speak to, but we talked on about 9 or 10 radio stations across the country. And, of course, the issues was a project that I've been working on with the National Sheriff's Association as the vice co-chair of the Border Security and Immigrations Committee.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the current status with the immigration situation in America. We talked about the border security issues and some issues on some of the bills, some of the interior enforcement bills that are mm-hmm. being discussed in Congress at this time.
Now, and I know we've discussed it before, but maybe for our listeners that are tuning in for the first time to the show, what's the importance to Rockingham County on issues like that?
Well, that's kind of the first question. Most of the, you know, I mean, it was a talk radio station from Bakersfield, California, Charlottesville, Virginia. I actually talked to a station day before yesterday from Raleigh.
Mm-hmm.
But the connection is this, is our borders are not secure in America, north, south, east, and west, and our ports of entry. We are pretty open. The problem with that is basically anybody can come through our borders. That, and I'm not saying everybody that comes across our borders has bad intent, but the persons do have ill will and intent that want to do things to harm our nation have that ability because we do not have closed, really secure borders. And that's what we're pushing for. If you truly want to protect America, you've got to start at our borders. Now, we do. We send great men and women, our fighting soldiers and sailors, Marines, Coast Guard, airmen. We send them to all parts of the world to protect our interests and also support other countries in their defense. But at the local level, you know, we need to do a better job of protecting our borders here in America, because the drug traffickers, the transnational drug trafficking organizations, criminal-type terrorists, human traffickers come through our border areas. 90% of the drugs, I understand, the methamphetamines, the heroin, the marijuana, the cocaine, comes right across our southern border with Mexico. Heroin coming out of Canada and stuff. Mm-hmm. I think two, three, four years ago, the actual Border Patrol stopped a guy that was actually bringing explosives through the Canadian border. So the borders are a big concern. But if we truly want to protect America and our citizens, we've got to do that. The second thing is in America, I do believe that the American citizens should be the first priority. I also believe that we need to return to the rule of law, and we need to treat all people equally and fairly. And persons that have, you know, we have, I think, a million people that come to America, that migrate to America every year to want to be part of the American way. Mm-hmm. And there's a process, and I believe, and sheriffs across the country believe, that persons that do things the lawful way, they should be rewarded. But again, that persons that choose not to follow our laws or abide by our laws, they should not get the benefits of living in America by doing the wrong thing, because you're sending out the wrong messages. I did make some inquiries about, there's a program that I understand where the State Department is flying some children from Central American countries into the U.S. to reunite them with their families, but I understand that only applies to children that actually qualify as asylees, persons that are in fear of being harmed in that country in which they live, and so they have to make that case through the State Department and through the immigration system to be able to participate. Mm-hmm. So my understanding is that they are doing that program, that the State Department does have a program to fly children from Central America into the U.S. to reunite with their families, but that's supposed to be for persons that are, my understanding, that are actually seeking asylum.
And just like you just said,
it's not a totally open program.
And just like you just said, and have said time and time again, to be clear, you're not faulting anybody for chasing the American dream.
No.
There's just a legal way to go about it. You support legal immigration.
My understanding, there are many people that come to our country every year through the lawful process.
Right.
We just believe in supporting the rule of law. And I want to be very clear. I support legal immigration. I think it's a wonderful thing. Our families, Roy, you know, we all came from other places and stuff like this, seeking the American dream and stuff like this. And that's why we're here today. But we do need to respect the rule of law, and I think that's something that we need to continue communicating to our congressmen, to our president, and to reaching out to others. So, again, that's part of the discussion that we had with the Radio Row, Hold the Feet to the Fire is the name of the program. Mm. It's hosted by Federation for American Immigration Reform, and I've participated with the program for about 4 years now.
Right.
And like I said, there are sheriffs from all over the country that we're in communication with. We have some. I met several interesting congressmen. I met Trey Gowdy. You know Trey Gowdy?
Yes.
You know, he's with the Benghazi issue and stuff. I talked to him just a little bit. He's out of South Carolina. I met Lou Barletta. Mm-hmm. He's up north, I think, Pennsylvania, congressman. I saw Steve King.
Mm-hmm.
He's a very well-known congressman on the immigration issue. I missed Jeff Sessions. I understand he was out there. I actually, when I was flying back yesterday, I saw Alma Adams, mm-hmm. who's a former city councilman and representative down in Raleigh.
Mm-hmm.
I saw her at the airport, and actually flew back with Mark Walker, congressman Mark Walker.
Okay.
So I was behind him in the aircraft, but I didn't bug him, you know, because he's had a hard week at work, and I was up there on vacation trying to learn some things and better educate myself, and also to communicate with some of the sheriffs that I work with also across the country on the projects. And it's all about protecting America, which in turn protects North Carolina, which in turn protects Rockingham County.
Right. Because what happens at the border doesn't stay at the border. We've said that time and time again.
Exactly.
It's here in 2 or 3 days.
Exactly. And I did make sure that that the listeners also understand that in Rockingham County, working with the DEA task force and surrounding local, state, and federal law enforcement agencies, 19 persons have been arrested since 2010 for drug trafficking issues and crimes in this county. And some of those have been attached directly back to the Mexican drug cartel. But most of
those were large amounts of drugs.
Those were large amounts. And most of those persons, I think the native country from those persons that were, those 19, were from Mexico. Mm-hmm. But again, like I said, some have been attached to the cartel. And as you know, the Mexican drug cartel is a dangerous organization that operates along the borders and controls a lot of the border areas in Mexico, the drug trafficking, the trade, the human trafficking. And that's something a lot of people don't realize, that human trafficking, you know, where people are bringing people over for either smuggling or human trafficking, that more that's the second most amount of money made next to the drug mm-hmm. trade with the border concerns. Right. So a lot of people are victimized, that become part of the human smuggling and drug and the human trafficking trade, and that is a serious business. We're trying to better educate ourselves here in the county and across the state with other sheriffs. To make sure that if we do see signs of human trafficking and human smuggling, we know how, what to do, how to recognize it, and who to contact to help eradicate that situation, because that's a very deadly situation for some that are involved in that, particularly the victims of that.
Right, right. Well, we've got lots more to talk about right here on Community Accents. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
WLOE Eden. WMYN Mandan. Listen online all the time. RockinghamCountyRadio.com.
And Kevin, you never know who you're going to meet. When I flew back in yesterday afternoon from Washington. When I was in the airport, I had my shirt on that has my embroidered badge and my name and everything, and sheriff. And I ran into a group of professionals from India that were there with the State Department, and they were getting ready to fly out to Des Moines, Iowa, mm-hmm. and but they had been in D.C. for a few days, and they were trying to figure out the role of the sheriff. And so I was talking to them, I was trying to explain to them, you know, my role in law enforcement. And we finally, because you know, a lot in India, a lot of their law enforcement is based on the military, so the British military.
Right, right.
So we talked about how you start out as a basic law enforcement officer, then you work up to inspector and so, kind of all that, uh-huh. and then superintendent's delay. And I kind of was relating it, but a little opportunity to do a little community outreach and international relations. But it was a neat group. And of course, we had to take a picture, you know that.
Mm-hmm.
So we did a photo op. But the guy with the State Department came over and thanked me for being a good ambassador. And I said, well, you know, we should all be good ambassadors, people from different countries and stuff. But it was kind of neat. But they've never met a sheriff before, so it was kind of cool. What else we got to talk about?
All right. Well, okay. Let's just dive right into it. One of the things that's made local news here recently is the sweepstakes, the announcement that the sweepstakes were going to be closing.
Yeah.
Effective April 1st, but now delayed enforcement until July 1.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell us where that decision came from. Explain it to our listeners.
Basically, the sweepstakes operation in October of last year was according to my understanding, the Court of Appeals came out, or Super Supreme Court of North Carolina,
right.
Became illegal. And our new district attorney, Greg Blitzer, great, great district attorney, by
right,
the way,
right.
Basically wanted to move forward on the issue. But the letter was originally sent out that said that they would be closing down or informing the businesses that run the sweepstakes they would need to close down April 1st.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened was, the businesses that within the townships, there was a question about permit fees and stuff like this. So the decision to hold off on the towns that had charged the fees until after July 1. And basically what I came back out with a letter after consulting with our law enforcement sheriff's office attorneys and the county attorney, decided to hold also, so it'd be more uniform in enforcement. So effective July 1,
mm-hmm.
all video sweepstakes in Rockingham County, unless there's a U.S. Supreme Court decision, which I don't expect, but would be shut down. So effectively, uh-huh. July 1, all the systems would be shut down and no longer be
so off. The sweepstakes in some of the cities, they had paid fees to operate
right,
until
right,
through July
right.
30th,
yeah.
or excuse me, July 1st. And I mean, you know, we can't pick and choose who we enforce the law over that.
Yeah, just to keep it real simple to understand is that the cities had a concern that conflicted with the concern that I had in the county. So after consulting with our legal advisors, we were advised to just basically join with their process, what they're doing, and basically hold till July 1. So effective July 1, there should be no video sweepstakes operating in Rockingham County. Mm-hmm. Unless there's a, like I said, a high court decision, our intent is to begin investigations and enforcement starting July 1. And so, you know, that's the message. So, you know, if you have a concern or you're upset, don't be upset. The Sheriff's Association of North Carolina has been fighting basic video gaming for about 14 years mm-hmm. of my 16 years as sheriff. And we still hold that same position. So effective July 1, if you're in the sweepstakes business, you know, that's your cutoff date. So, you know, right. You shouldn't be operating anymore after July 1 of this year. All right, what else we got?
All right, let's talk about the inmate litter removal program. We've got that up and going. For those that don't know, tell the listeners what right. that is and what they can expect.
Well, you know, there's some sheriff's officers across the state and across the country that have believe that a good thing they can do is to get the inmates volunteer, get the inmates to come out and work to help clean up their communities, but also it teaches the inmates, it's, and like I say, it's a volunteer program, but it teaches inmates about some good work ethic, about giving back to the community. And it's a win-win because mm-hmm. we get our streets and neighborhoods cleaned up, particularly with the trash issues. And then the inmates also learn about, like I say, working together, teamwork. They learn about good work ethic. They learn about giving back to the community. They learn about being what we want them to be, which is returning back to society, to be part of society, not separate from society. Mm-hmm. So because, you know, if you have someone in jail, and a lot of people that go to our jails locally are only in there for a short period of time. Mm-hmm. And if you have the person there and you never try to instill something positive or something good in that person, what do you expect when they return back to society?
Yeah, same and go out old, in the, same old. Yeah.
Same old, same old. So we want to break that cycle of basically criminality and people that are basically returning back to the same old
same lifestyles
mm-hmm. and we want to instill something positive in that person, because I believe that people can change, and I believe that if we make the effort, and that's on our part, we need to make the efforts to show people where they need to be and give them that opportunity. So what we're doing is thanks to our county commissioners, thanks to our county manager, thanks to our volunteer inmates that are volunteering, they're able to get out and work. Now the incentives are, number one is they do get to get outside, because I think most persons that are locked up in our jail facility do like the opportunity to be able to get out and breathe some fresh air. But the second thing, they learn some positive good work ethic. And the other thing is, if they do a good job, I can actually take a few days off their sentence per month, mm-hmm. up to 4 days. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if they work hard and do a good job, we can reward them. Right. But again, keyword, it's a volunteer program, but we've just started it this month. We've been underway, but again, I want to thank my commissioners for being able to help bring the technical side together, because we had to figure out a way to pay for this. Mm-hmm. And what they did was they went through the legislature to change it where we could use enterprise funds that are generated at the landfill mm-hmm. from the processes out there, mm-hmm. and a percentage of those funds go back to covering equipment and safety equipment and fuel and everything and the personnel. Because we have a sergeant and a deputy mm-hmm. that are out with the work crews, and we try to work them Monday through Friday, X number of hours a day. I think it's anywhere from 4 to 6 hours a day going out to the different communities. So if you see some guys out there in orange jumpsuits and stuff like this, they're doing a good job. They're working to give back to Rockingham County, mm-hmm. and we applaud them. And I've stopped by and thanked them. I said, you're doing a great job, guys, and keep up the good work. Because when those persons get out of the jail in 30 days or 60 days, I want them to know that there are people that do believe in them, and they need to start believing in themselves. Right. And I think you can get change started, but you got to start somewhere. So this is our start, and we're able to do it now. But the good thing is, there's, you know, as far as tax dollars, we're using revenues that are generated from the landfill, mm-hmm. but not taking from the general fund. So it's a good process,
and it's saving money that the county would have had to pay somebody subcontracting to clean up
exactly,
the side of the road.
Exactly. So, yeah. And somebody's going to ask, well, Sheriff, if I have a road that's dirty, what our process is we're starting with all the main roads going into all the communities, and we're going to try to get those cleaned up, the landfill area, where roads going into the landfill, areas where we see habitual problem areas. And the other thing is I'm going to encourage the local police and my deputies, when they see somebody throw out some trash, we're gonna start picking it up on the enforcement. Not every day will anybody normally throw out trash in front of an officer, but if we observe it, that's a fine up to what?
$200, I believe.
I think it goes up to $500 more. Yeah, it's okay. Some places I've seen some communities where it's $1,000 fine for littering. So the thing about it is,
if you've got trash, let's say this,
if you've got trash, keep it in your car. Find a receptacle, but don't throw trash out. Don't throw cigarette butts out. This during the time we're having these dry spells.
Yes.
That can start fires. And our forestry service, I know that they and the fire marshal will encourage you to do not throw out cigarette butts because those things can smolder and start fires. But also, don't throw out trash. Let's continue to beautify Rockingham County because we love our county. Mm-hmm. We care about it. And working with the commissioners, working with all communities, we're going to work together to beautify our communities. And it starts, and our program is going to start at the ground level, mm-hmm. working at the streets, trying to communicate one piece of trash at a time.
There you go. All right. Keystone Cops for the Arts. Tell us about it.
All right. That's on May
9th.
Keystone.
Saturday before Mother's Day, if you want to. Use that as a marker for your calendar.
So it's no excuse.
No excuse.
It's at 8 o'clock, we'll be doing registration from.
Starts at 7.
7 to, and what time does the first run start?
The runs are a little bit later. The rides, yeah, I believe it is 9. The rides, I think, start at 8.
Okay. All right. What it is Keystone Cops for the Arts. Basically, is a program where a lot of corporations and businesses and supporters, the sheriff's office, and law enforcement, we're coming together. We'll be at the courthouse. Outside, and we'll have all types of it's like a carnival and a festival
this year. Since it was such a big hit last year, we will be continuing the festival, and we've grown upon it.
We'll have food, we'll have music, we'll have 5K runs, we'll have a 10.
It's a 10:30 and 60-mile bike ride.
Yeah, 10:30 and 60-mile ride, and you get to tour the beautiful Rockingham County roads, mm-hmm. and they're nice. And it's nice courses. We'll have a 5K run. We'll have the 1 mile. Run, and then you'll have a fun run walk.
Yes.
Okay. Sir. You'll have representation from the North Carolina National Guard, and you'll have
we should have the rock wall back this year at the carnival section.
Climb the rock wall. Yes.
We've got all kinds of games and
you're
stuff.
You're gonna be out there with community programs, community right. watch, crime prevention.
We're also gonna have a table set up to where the kids can do little crafts to give to their mothers for Mother's Day.
They do the face painting and all that.
Face painting, all that stuff.
Starting at 8 or 8:30.
8 to 3.
Get out to the Rockingham County Courthouse, located conveniently in downtown Wentworth.
Mm-hmm.
And come out. Plenty of parking. Come out, enjoy yourself, bring the kids. It'll be a wonderful morning and afternoon. And I'm going to get a run in because I've been running a little bit. I'm going to get a little run in. I might not run fast, but I'll get there. And again,
Where does all the money go? The money
goes to the arts for Rockingham County. The music,
schools.
The schools, yeah. Rockingham County school system. You know, we hear a lot about the deficits and people, school system is short on a lot of areas. Well, you know, when you go visit the schools, you find out that the arts a lot of times are the first programs to be cut or mm-hmm. cut back. Mm-hmm. So we want to do our part. Now, Tom Harris, who's one of the high-up guys there at Keystone.
Keystone Foods, yes.
Tom and I both were in the band in high school and the marching band. Uh-huh. But we do support the arts. Dr. Shotwell was there. The president of Keystone Foods was out there, and Tina and everybody. So we're looking forward to Keystone Cops for the Arts, and that's going to be on Saturday, May
9th.
Registration starts
Saturday
at 7, but they're going to open at 8 and go till about how late?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock.
And kids come out and make something nice for your mom. We've got little crafts and stuff. All that stuff will be free to do.
And climb wall, free climb wall.
Yes.
So come out and challenge me to the climbing wall.
Yeah, that should be
that
awesome.
Should be fun.
Yeah, okay. All right, now we're at the top of the hour, so this is one thing that I want to go over right before we run out of time. Been in the news all over the place with some of these happenings, interactions between law enforcement and citizens. Body cameras. Where are we at on that?
All right, we've been doing research for the past 3 months, and we've narrowed it down on which body cams we think would be the best. Yes, we are going to go to the body cams. We've got a letter we'll be providing to the county manager. We'll be providing to the. I think he'll be reading it to the county commissioners Monday night mm-hmm. at the commission meeting. But basically, request for $25,000 a starting fee to help us purchase body cams for all of our patrol officers out there. And then we also have a grant in for $10,000 that we will be able to, if everything stays good, after July 1, we'll be able to use that toward body cameras also. Mm-hmm. So our intent is to purchase the body cams to help protect the officers, help protect the public, to help continue with that transparency issue that you hear so much about, mm-hmm. to make sure that, that we're documenting what our guys are doing out there in the field, mm-hmm. and also have a way to capture that information and provide that later for either court or if you know any other issues arise, we'll be able to draw from that information. Right. But the body cams are something that you're seeing more and more agencies going to, and I realize, you know what, that's something we for 21st century policing, yes, we're going to go.
We've been looking at the body camera since the end of last year.
Well, the biggest thing was the cost. Money, because the units are about $500 a piece. Mm. So we want to make sure that we get what's going to be best for our organization and how to be able to use that and capture that information and use that later if we need to.
All right.
But again, it'll help us, it'll help the public, and we want to do everything we can to better serve the citizens of Rockingham County. So we feel like the body cams are good, moving in a good direction. Anything else? Community Watch. Don't forget, if you want to start a Community Watch group, you don't have to have hundreds of people, 30, 40, 50 people. You may only have start off with two or three or four people. But if you're interested in starting a Community Watch group in your neighborhood to better protect your neighborhood, contact Kevin Suthard at what number?
634-3065 is my direct line at the office.
We need you to help support Crime Stoppers of Rockingham County at the number?
349-9683 to give your tips or whatever.
And if you'd like to make a donation, they're 501c3.
Right. It's tax deductible, and they run strictly off of donation. So we need your help, ladies.
Yes, sir. And that's how we pay out for our rewards for Crime Stoppers. So if you want to help out Crime Stoppers, make a donation. If you have any questions about Crime Stoppers, contact Kevin Suthard. If you have any questions about Community Watch groups, contact our Crime Prevention Officer, Kevin Suthard.
And it really does work, ladies and gentlemen. Those are two programs that are very effective in law enforcement.
We thank everybody for giving us the opportunity to serve. Again, I'm looking forward to a great weekend this weekend. Got a lot of events going on. And if you have any questions or concerns, please don't hesitate to call us at the Sheriff's Office at 634-3239. I'm Sheriff Sam Page.
I'm Kevin Suthard. We'll see you next month right here on Community Access.